passing off into the sky through countless stoves and furnaces when the natural gas containing it was burned as fuel. It presented a unique problem of conservation. Forests can be recreated. Worn-out land can be restored. But once helium is wasted into the air, it is lost forever. So, for helium, a new kind of conservation program was needed. And in 1960, a bill to conserve helium was passed by Congress and signed by the President, launching a modern epic of cooperation between private industry, building and operating new multi-million dollar plants for the extraction of helium, and government, storing and refining it. The northernmost of these extraction plants is at Bushton, Kansas. Here, as at all the plants, natural gas en route to fuel markets is diverted long enough to extract the helium. Basically, the extraction of helium from the natural gas in which it is found is done by making the mixture progressively colder until practically everything else turns to liquid and only the helium remains as a gas. This cooling is done by repeated cycles of compression, heat removal, and expansion of the natural gas. The temperature dropping with each expansion in exactly the same way as the temperature is lowered in a home refrigerator until at about 275 degrees below zero, everything else has condensed out as liquid except a helium-nitrogen mixture called crude helium, which remains as a gas. This crude helium is collected in a government pipeline system and transported to the cliffside field near Amarillo, where it is metered and stored deep underground, rock-bound, in a mammoth 12,000-acre formation from which it can be withdrawn when needed. Four other private industry-built plants add their helium to the pipeline. The Ulysses plant in southwestern Kansas, where 500 million cubic feet of gas are cooled every day in the world's largest horizontal heat exchanger. The plant near Liberal, Kansas, the largest helium extraction plant in the free world, where the crude helium is separated out in this unique 169-foot fractionating tower. And two plants in northern Texas, where the gas compression problem was solved in totally different ways, each best adapted to its situation. At the Sherman plant, on the border between the Texas and Oklahoma panhandles, the power for compressing the natural gas is furnished by huge reciprocating engines. While at the plant near Dumas, a few miles south, this small structure houses a single aircraft jet engine, which provides roughly as much power as four of the reciprocating engines at Sherman. Besides these five plants built and operated by private industry, there are five older plants built and owned by the government, like this one at Keyes, Oklahoma, where, in addition, helium is refined to its pure state and shipped to meet the current needs of federal agencies and other users.
Remember New York's annual Thanksgiving Day parade, folks? Balloons, all helium filled.
Well, this was how they looked in 1958, filled with air and carried by cranes, when there was not enough plant capacity to provide sufficient helium for all demands, including far more important ones than this. The loss of the free world's supply of helium has been checked, and reserves are being built up for the future. But there's a lot we're still throwing away. Billions of cubic feet of the precious gas are vanishing into space every year. And this may prove to be the costliest resource we ever wasted. For helium, let it be said again, is not only essential to the defense of our nation, but its use for the future. Use is already discovered and as yet undiscovered, perhaps in the jet flames of the plasmas. The production and control of energy sources similar to the sun are beyond any man's dreaming. The calm, quiet element that we ignored so long is now indispensable. Let us use him wisely and guard him well. Our old Earth has a very limited supply of helium. And when H.E. is gone. We can never get him back.